so much for being here. My name is Kimberly Tate Malone, and I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here. We're so glad that you're able to join the show pans. How many folks have been to a COSI before? Jason, yeah. Just a few of us, I see some familiar faces. But for those of you who are new with us today, I want to explain why we do this in the library. So we want everyone to have access to a wide range of information on different topics that are important in our lives. And we believe that whether or not you agree with every single thing you hear in here, or read in the books that are available for checkout up here, or find our databases, we want everyone to have access to it so we can learn from a wide range of viewpoints. So, if you are interested in leading a session, we have students, faculty, staff, and community members, and if you're passionate about a topic and would like a forum, please come talk to me and we can get you on the winter schedule for next year. Fall is already filled up. But at the end of this session, I'll ask you to fill out a very brief survey, letting me know what you liked, how we can improve, so that we can keep these relevant to you. So this is our last COSI of the quarter, and you've already seen our presenter, but let me introduce her. This is Halimah Bellows, and
Hello.
She is one of the South Seattle College faculty members, and she is here to talk to us today about how to win in the world of work and champion your career. So we also have some books from Halimah. If you'd like to purchase them from the bookstore, you can also take a glance and see what's there so you know what you'd be purchasing, right? So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Halimah.
I appreciate it. Hello, everyone. Sorry I was a tiny bit late, but I made it anyway. So what I would like to know, because there is a lot that I could talk about. I mean, there's so many things about trying to champion your career. It's like, what brought you in here? What do you want to know? And then I can focus on that. You know, like, why are you here? Why did you choose this conversation to come to?
I have to be here.
You have to be here. Okay. Whatever that means.
It's part of my class.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you. Well, what do you want to learn? That's the other thing. Yeah.
Do you know about the different career?
Career paths?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. What do you want to learn? Why have you come here? Like, well, what can I, you know, I'm trying to focus my talk on, you know, maybe what your interests are. So, what do you want to learn? Okay. Maybe you could speak a little more loudly, because some of you are really speaking really soft. Yeah.
I'm a little confused about my career or the future, so I want to learn more like management skill for my future and do some prediction.
Okay, thank you. Yes, ma'am.
So I want to know about how do I choose my major and maybe the relationship between my major and my job in the future.
Okay. I have some stuff on that actually, yes.
I just want like a little like a real push like to like a little guidance to like how do I know like what I want to do or like what like how to like achieve things.
Okay, great, thank you.
Some of the key factors in nailing a job, nailing a good job interview.
Okay. job interviews I'm not actually gonna talk about today. I could do that another time, but not today. But but you still have to know, key factor is you have to know who you are at a job interview. You have to be able to sell yourself, right? Yeah.
Yeah, so I have, like, I know what I like, so I just want to know how to set up a pathway to achieve the career that I want.
Okay, all right, great. So I heard the same thing a few times. So, in fact, that's what I thought I was going to talk about anyway, is the first thing that, you know, I think I have a thing up here, yes, this is called the career quest process, and it's kind of like a triangle, but you start at the bottom. The first thing, and that's what actually, and I did write a book about it, the first thing is, at the bottom, and that's the, you have to know yourself. You have to know who you are. And that's what I'm going to spend a little bit, most of my time on. But then once you figure that out, then you want to start gathering information about the work world, what's out there. Today, with the internet, with social media, very easy to get information on careers, very easy. So you need to figure out, once you know who you are, then you figure out, I need information. What jobs are going to match these things? Then you're going to sort of define it, you're going to evaluate it, you're going to make a plan. So we want to talk about the bottom, which is you have to answer the question, who am I? Right? And that involves, when you're looking particularly for a career, it means, what are my interests? Right? What are my interests? What are the things that I like to do? You know, what are some magazines that I read? What are the books that I'm attracted to in a library? What section do I go into? How do I spend my free time? Right. So you have to know, what are my interests? Once you figure that out, and that involves also looking at passion. What am I passionate about? You can think about perhaps, you know, you can think about what was an activity that I was doing the last time I lost track of time. Time went by so fast that, oh, it's over. Because I was so involved in what I was doing. So what am I passionate about? Right, and that has to do with interest, passions, purpose. Okay. So that's first, what are my interests? Second one has to do with, what are my values? I'm big on values. I mean, because you have two kinds of values. You've got personal values and you've got work values. And you have to look at, you know, like, and I can give you some example of values. If we talk about values, personal work values, for example, if you are, for me, like one of my biggest values is variety. Everybody know what that means? Variety? Okay. Which means I don't like to do the same thing all the time. I like to do different things. So that's my value, variety. So if you value variety and flexibility, then those are one of my top values, you do not want to work, for example, in a factory, you know, just stamp, 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 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. Because you're doing the same thing every day, right? So that's kind of an example of value, is that that would not be suitable for you. Now, if you like routine, and you like doing the same thing over and over again, and because that makes you feel happy and comfortable, by all means, go work in a shoe factory, wherever you want to work. So so another example of values, and I take this one to an extreme, but so you can get the idea of it, is, for example, if you value, one of your values is like world peace. You really, you're a very peaceful person, you don't believe in violence and all of that, and you work for a company that makes bombs. I mean, it's not gonna fit, is it? I mean, even though you may not be the bomb maker, I mean, company, big companies like Boeing, for example, they have many, many different jobs. I mean, you could be an accountant there, you could be a, yeah. But the point is, the mission of the company doesn't match yours. So you don't want to work in some place like that. So those are the extremes on values, but it gives you a picture of what I'm talking about, right? So what do I value? As I say, personal, work. And the other one to look at is, and we can look at a few things on this, is skills. Anybody can tell me what skills are? Skill, what's a skill?
Capability of doing something.
Yes, I mean something that you can do. Driving is a skill, for example. Usually skills are things that you learn and that you can do. Some things come to you, natural ability. I mean, you ever see a little kid, you know, playing with blocks and he can build like a building, he's 4 years old. Wow, that kid has a natural, he's probably gonna do something with that, because it's just, sometimes we're born with talents, we can be very, an artist, it's like it's given to us, but we need skills and techniques to perfect it. So it's like, you look at the skills. What are the skills that I have? And we all have many, many skills. The other one you want to look at with the skills is, what are the, these are the skills I have, what are the ones that I enjoy doing? Really a key here. Because again, for, and I mentioned driving. I can drive, it's a skill. I'm glad I know how to do it. It gets me from point A to point B. However, I would not want to spend all my day behind the wheel of a car. So I would not go into any job that would involve me driving a lot, because I don't like it. Okay. So what are the skills that I have? What are the skills that I enjoy using? And the last is, of the skills that I have, what are the ones that I want to do on the job? Because, you know, knowing how to like sort of ski is a skill. Skiing is a skill, it's a sport. You may really, really enjoy skiing, but do you want to work as a, you know, a ski instructor? Maybe not, maybe something you're interested in, but it's not a skill you want to take to a job, though you could. You can make hobbies jobs very easily. So those are the three big things you have to look at. Okay. Interest, values, skills. And one thing I say about values, as I say, I'm really, really big on them, is I really believe that to the extent, okay, that you live and honor your values is the extent to which you are going to find fulfillment and happiness in life. I truly believe that. I've come across many, many people as a career counselor who come to me and say, I'm not happy with my job. I need a change. And when I ask them questions, it usually comes out that their values are not being met. So it's really, really important to consider all of those. As I say, the book that I wrote called Champion Your Career, Winning in the World of Work, does have chapters on, you know, finding interest, finding values, finding skills. So those are the three main things. Once you do that, and it can take time, you may not do it overnight, certainly you can do it by reading books, you can do it by going on the internet. There are a lot of career assessments on the internet. You can go see a counselor here at the college. It's free service. Use it. There's a career center here. Use it, please. Go see your counselor. Tell them, I don't know what I want to do. Can you help me figure it out? They will. What they'll do probably, as I've just said, is they'll probably give, they may give you a career assessment. I call it a test, but it's not really a test because there's no right answer. Test implies there's one answer that's correct. An assessment is just, it's just asking you, what do you like? And so whatever you tell it is the correct answer. So there are assessment tests that you can take that will, you know, help figure out what your interests are, passions, you know, there are some, I mean, you might know your skills, you can take values, inventories. So there are things that you can do with all of those to try and figure out what it is, okay? Does anyone have any questions? Well, please stop me if I'm talking too fast or you wanna, no? All right. I did bring something, some handouts to give you at the end so you can play a little bit, you know, you can try a couple activities so we can have some fun with that. But I did want to talk to you first about this. Okay, so basically that's really what it is. You've got to figure out who you are. Those are the steps. Once you do that, then you've got to, then you do research in the world of work. You know, then you do, and you brainstorm, you talk to people. And by the way, one of the best ways to learn, well, I'll ask you first. What do you think is one of the best ways to learn about a job? Kimberly's raising her hand. Okay.
Yeah, talk to someone who has that job.
And she's 100% correct. That's exactly right. You want to, we call these, and if you take a career class, you can do it. And they're called, so they're called informational interviews because you're going to talk to people who are doing the job and ask them about it. And there are questions that you can ask them. You can always ask them, what do you like about it? What do you do every day? You know, and there's a set of questions that you can use, but they're called information. And the best way is to ask somebody who's doing it because they know. So, what career are you interested in?
Ultrasound technician. Ultrasound diagnostic technician.
Ah! I think it's the other way around. I think it's diagnostic ultrasound technician, but I could be wrong. Ultrasound diagnostic technician, okay. So the best way to find out about that job is to talk to somebody who's actually doing it. So what you do with that is say, well, I don't know anybody. Ask your friends, ask your family members, ask your teachers, you know. Do you know anybody who does this job that might be willing to talk to me for like, you know, 15, 20 minutes that I could actually interview? So that's actually the best way to find out. The other is to, with informational interviews, the other related to that is to, we call it, job shadowing. Anybody know what that is? Any idea? Nobody's raising their
hand. Following in their footsteps.
Yes, good for you. Following in their footsteps, exactly. Finding somebody that you can say, can I follow you around for the day or for a couple hours and see what you do? That's job shadowing. So that way, you can get an idea of, you know, what kind of workplace do they work in? Who do they talk to? Do they wear a uniform? You know, do they sit? Do they stand? What do they do? So that's another really good way to find out about. You can read about it, and I would say first read about the jobs, you know, try and look at the jobs you're interested in, then see if you can set some of these up to figure it out, what I want to do. Yes?
Can I just make a plug? So if you're interested in finding out about a job, and before you get to the informational interview job shadowing, you want to learn more, we actually have different databases like WOIS that will tell you what kind of credentialing you need, what kind of education does it take, what's the average wage, how is this job going? What's like the job outlook? And so that way you'll have a basic understanding of what that job entails so that when you ask someone to talk to them about their job, you have done your research and you're not coming saying, I don't even know what this is or what do I need? What kind of degree do I need? And you'll be able to more focus on those things that you haven't been able to find out through other avenues, right? So
exactly. There's a lot of these days, I mean, a tremendous amount of career information on the internet, and many, many career resources that you can look up. And their colleges have databases, and then there's government publications, and so many things that you can actually read, you know, about what do I do? What is this job? You know, what is it involved?
A lot.
Okay. So does anybody have any questions so far? And I think what I've said, I think, is probably the most, is you have to do intense, what I call, self-assessment. Okay. Now I want to talk briefly. Let's do this. This is what's called. Anybody ever do anything on the Holland Code? Okay. This is career development theory. It's a little bit of theory. John Holland came up with this theory, and it is still valid today. Figuring out a career that's right for me has not changed. You still have to go through the same steps. What has changed is the job search. That's very different now than it was 10, 15 years ago. But the process is the same. And what he said was that all people and all jobs can be divided into 6 categories. And the categories are realistic. It's a hexagon. I can erase this. I can't draw, by the way. That is not one of my skills. Is this one okay for this?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, it's corners. So it's not a very good. I told you I can't draw. It's even with a ruler. It's a hexagon. Okay, and the categories are realistic. So realistic people, you know, basically the athletes, the mechanics. People like to work with objects. People like to work with things. Animals, and they like to work outdoors. That's realistic. The other is the investigative. Those are the scientists. People like to investigate things, research, find out information, analyze, solve problems. Okay. The A, obviously, is the artistic. And that's pretty, you know, we like art. We enjoy artistic things. S is social. Right? Social. People that like to work with people. These are usually the teachers, the counselors, things like that. And then the enterprising. These are the businessmen. The lawyers. Not that I want to mention his name, but like Donald Trump is a very enterprising person. He likes to influence. He likes to sell. He likes to lead, he likes to manage. A lot of the businessmen are like that. So those are the 6 categories. So we could play a tiny little game here, which is called the party exercise, and we can do that.
And what was the C?
Oh, sorry, I'm sorry. Conventional. So these are, I mean, in a way it's conventional, it's kind of conservative. These are the people who like to work with data, numbers, very detail-oriented. Accountants, for example, would be someone in the conventional category. So let's say, and all of you can take out, we're going to get a quick, I can use this word, we can get a little quick thing of people's codes here. This is a quick way of doing it, but let me just say that a lot of the assessment instruments that you take, like the Strong, which is a pretty
It's used many, many times. Interest inventory, and I believe the counselors here actually have that test that they could give you. It will at the end, it's gonna give you a three-letter code based on how you answer the questions. Because he basically said that all people and all jobs can be divided into six categories, and people who are, you know, realistic like to spend more time with people that are like them. Pretty much what it is. So, if you think of these six categories, let's say you are at a party, okay? And you go in to the party, and you see there's six corners of the room. These are the six corners. You have people here that are, like, realistic, investigative. So, where do you go first? Can you write it down? Who do you want to talk to? Who do you want to spend your time with? Write down one of these. Realistic, investigative, artistic. Social, enterprising. Realistic could also be like farmers. The investigative are probably now the IT people. So everybody write down where they wanted to go. Wrote down one of these corners. Okay, so you've spent 15, 20 minutes talking. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna write down, like, you're gonna write down, me, I'd probably go to the social people first. I'd write down an S. So you spend 20 minutes with these people and they all leave. Nothing to do with you. They just had to pick up a kid at the airport or had a doctor's appointment or whatever. They're all gone. So where are you going to go to next? Which other corner of the room will you go to when you talk to, when you go to the realistic or the conventional or the enterprising? So write another letter down.
So what is people in the conventional category?
Accountants, maybe administrative assistants, people, mathematicians, people who like to work with data, data entry. And the same thing, talking to them, having a good time, learning a lot of things. And again, 15, 20 minutes, they all have to leave. Again, not your fault, they just gotta go. So, where's the last place you'd go? Which corner of the room? You're gonna talk to the realistic, the investigative, the artistic, the social, the enterprising, or the conventional? Everybody write that down? So, you should have now on a piece of paper, this is a quick way of doing it, really quick. Let's talk about a two-letter code. So, I'm just curious to see where people are. What's yours? What's your code? Just give me S, A, I, S, whatever.
A.
And the second?
S.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, just quickly tell me. I'm just gonna go around the room. Hello? Yes. And? Okay. Yes.
C-E.
Okay. Oh, that's an interesting one. Yes.
C-E.
Okay.
A-E.
Yes.
A-E.
All right. Yes. Yeah. Did you tell me? You do?
That's I.
That's I.
Voting up.
I do. I do. Okay, so it's kind of interesting that we're all different, few people the same. So, if you know that your interests are like social and artistic, those are the kind of jobs that you're going to look for. And it's interesting to know that all government publications, Occupational Outlook Handbook, which is a resource, the O-Net, all of those, they use the Holland Code and they have job titles in every one of these categories. So you can actually do some, if you know you're an I, you can go look up the what are the jobs that are investigative? What are the jobs that are social? And you can get a lot of information. Once you have that, then you want to do some more research on them. We'll go on informational interviews and so on. So, also what Holland said is that the closer, and I'm sorry, this is such a terrible hexagon. And we have a few people like that, like AS. So the closer the two letter codes are together, the easier it is going to be for you to find something that you would like to do. If they, however, and we do have somebody over here who put CA, because in a sense, conventional and artistic are actually very opposite each other. The way they behave, the way they think, the way they do things. So if you are a CA, it's not to say that you will never find anything that you like to do, but it's going to take more work to figure it out. And that's true. So it's just a little quickly, a little easy way to kind of figure out some, you know, what are my categories, what are my interests, because this is an interest inventory. But as I say, you do research on this, and you'll get a lot of information. Okay. Anybody have any questions? All right. What I want to touch on. I want to talk about college majors. And there are, and I'm going to just kind of go through this really quickly. There are actually, people have ideas about college majors. Let me say this to you, however, that you're all students here at Seattle Central. You're just sort of beginning. You don't have to pick one now. Okay, you can explore, because this is the time, right, to take classes that are of interest to you, because many people start off with one major and then they change to something else and they don't stick with the same thing. So don't feel, I have to choose this now. No, you don't. You know, you could do it, you know, general. Now, I mean, now sometimes people do know that you're lucky if you do. You may know. My sister, for example, she knew at 10 years old that she wanted to be a librarian. I'm going to be a librarian. And that's what she became. She knew it. It was the right job for her. She's still doing it. Okay. But that's not true. And if that's true, you're lucky. A lot of people have to, you know, do some explanation. Now, here's a question for you. Can anyone venture a guess as to how many times... and this is in the United States, so I know some of you look like you come from other countries. I don't know about other countries, but I know about the U.S. What do you think is the average amount of time that people change careers? And I'm not talking about jobs. That's even more. Careers. For example, going from an accountant to being a nurse, to being an actor. I mean, they're completely different. So, what do you think is the average time, average amount of time, number of people change careers in their life? it used to be 3 to 5. But with the changing workplace, it's more. I'll go to this. It's more like 4. I mean, I think the last I read, it's more like 7, but it's probably 4 to 5. And that's careers. So what I'm saying is, you're young, you can explore, you can try things out. You may find after 5 years you don't like it anymore. That's fine, I want to go back to school, I have all these skills, I'm going to try something else. That's perfectly okay, right? So it's like, you don't have to decide this minute and that's what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. That doesn't happen anymore today in today's workplace. Does not happen. Okay. So I just want to tell you that, don't go, oh, God, I'm choosing a major. I'll try and read this. I've got some facts about college majors, so I'll tell you one. So, what I call myths of college majors. So, myth one is, the sooner you decide, the better. Well, I just told you that that's not true, and that's right. It says 80% of students who enter college have not yet decided on one. And it says, research says that many, if you have an advantage, that's fine, but many people change. And I say this, and you don't have to really decide until you kind of get into your junior year. And it says, myth two, well, I'll eventually find one. I'll just wait and it'll come to me. Well, no, it's talked about career planning. It's not passive. You do have to take some action. You know, you start researching, you get information, you take assessment tests, you figure out what it is that I want to do. Myth three might be, well, someone else can decide for me. That happens sometimes in families. If your father, for example, is a doctor, he's going to encourage you to become a doctor. He'd say, I want you to go to, you know, I want you to study biology, and I want you to go to medical school. I mean, I know someone actually that happened to. They went through 1 year of medical. They said, medical school, no, it is not for me. I am not my father. I am going to do something different. So don't necessarily let other people choose for you. Figure it out yourself. Consider it. Again, sometimes people say, I'm going to choose a job or major based on what is happening in the job market. I want a job that I know, a career that I can find a job in. Well, that's true. Obviously, you could study for 4 years and get a degree in like acting, theater, great occupation, but most people who go into theater probably never actually end up working in it because it's, you know, it's like, what is it? The statistic is, for every one actor that is employed, there are 1,000 that are not. You work that number. But if you're in college and you like theater, why not major in it? Have fun, enjoy it. It's going to teach you a lot of skills. And then you can go out and do something else. Because a lot of people who major in theater don't necessarily end up being actors. Okay. Find something that you enjoy, that you like. As I said, interest. Have fun with it. Enjoy it. Take extracurricular activity. Again, it says, your major predicts your career. And again, not necessarily so. If I major in theater, the likelihood I'm going to be an actor is not high. It's true you can find jobs in it, but certain careers will prepare you for other careers. Okay. And again, it says over 50%, another statistic, of college graduates are not in a career today that was their major. Over 50%. And some of them are very happy doing what they're doing. What they look for is they look for qualities that you have in the major. For example, people might think, well, I'm a liberal arts major, I don't have anything that people are going to want, which is not true. If you are a liberal arts major, which is kind of like English, philosophy, history, things like that, you can learn a lot of things within that major that is going to help you get a job. Okay. And let me say this. And there are a few others. So what I'm saying is you can take your time, take classes that you enjoy, have fun. Now, the other thing I wanted to say is, and I don't know if anybody knows this, I'll tell you about it. Is, for example, a lot of people like to major in English, right? Anybody have English, want to do English? You did English?
No, I
did
English. Okay. Or history.
Yeah, I did.
You did history?
Yeah, and ethnic studies.
Ethnic studies, all right. So let's say you made, because people like to read, they like literature, they like to write. You can go online and you can Google this question. What can I do with a, with a major in English or anything else? What can I do with a major in English? What can I do with a degree in history? What can I do with a degree in biology, right? Just, you Google it. And you would be absolutely amazed at the number of different things that come up that tell you what you can do with a major in. And a lot of people don't know that. And that's a really good way to get ideas for careers to do more research on. You know, you can get picked three or five that, oh, I never thought about that one. Let me find out more about this career. Let me do some research. Let me talk to people. Let me read about it.
Okay. You can give those to me when you walk in.
What are you giving them to me for?
I'm not sure.
All right, just curious, have people yet chosen their major? Anybody? Has anybody here decided what they want to major in?
Yeah.
Marketing. Okay. Now again, you think, well, marketing but it means selling, but you can do the same thing. What can I do with a major in marketing? And you can come up with some, a lot of ideas that maybe you had not thought about. It's a really great way to brainstorm, as I call it. Just generate ideas, ideas, ideas. So, I pulled this one out the other day, which is called, which is a degree in, which is actually what I studied, which was sociology. What can I do with a degree in sociology? All right, so, yes, you can work in social services. First of all, you get, this one came out with social service, community, law, college, health, business, publishing, teaching. I mean, a lot of careers just from this major in sociology. Now, a lot of majors, by the way, sometimes it's not enough, you know, if for example, I majored in sociology and I want to be a social worker, I have to do further training to get, I have to do a master's degree to be a social worker, be an MSW. So sometimes with a major, you know, it may give you a very broad base, but if you want a career more specifically, you may have to go to grad school. Others, you don't. So, I want to do a couple quick things here. Let's just try a couple of these. People have some paper. So I just want to talk a little bit about majors. So what I'm trying to say is you don't have to decide now. Take classes that you enjoy. Experiment. Try them out. That's how you learn. You take a class in philosophy. Oh, God, this is fascinating. I love this. I want more. Okay. That's how you choose. So does anybody have any questions? All right, so what I want to do is I have this here.
Question back here.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know, I came a little bit late, but I kind of have a question. When you're picking a major, you know, some people say you should do something you love, and some people say you should choose money, go after the money. And I was just trying to see if you could talk about it, like, give a little bit of what you feel about that.
I think I did, but...
I missed it, that's why I said I came late.
Yeah. It depends on, I would say that depends on your financial situation. For example, if, you know, when you go to school and you need to work, like right away, you know, you can't do grad school or internship, you know, you might want to choose a career that's going to pay you money immediately. But then, once you're doing that, you can do further study to find out more about what you like. It's really up to you. But there are skills that you can do to earn money, you know, things that you can do to earn money while you're going to school, studying something that you're interested in. I mean, you know, if you like to drive, I mean, you could be a bus driver. It's not that hard to be one. You could be a taxi driver. I mean, it's a way to earn money, right? So, I mean, I would say, as a particular, I would say this. If you're young, you know, let's say not over, like, 30.
Yeah, I'm at that mark.
Or even 35. I mean, a lot of you look like you're in your 20s, many of you. You have time. And as I say, you're probably going to change your career anyway. So you don't have to take what you enjoy. Take different classes. I mean, you know, because the general ed degree, you have to take, you know, 2 years of GEs, a little bit of everything. That gives you time to explore what it is I want to do. Then you can choose a major to go on, right? So you don't have to rush. This is your time to please enjoy your youth. That's all I have to say. Enjoy it. Have fun. Okay. Now, if let's say you are 40 and are returning to school, for example, and you know perhaps you've been working, you've been laid off from your job, you need. Or maybe you got injured on the job, that's another possibility. You need to find something, you know, you're gonna go back to school. You know, you want to do something more specific of when I finish this, I can get a job as. I mean, because again, later in life, you don't have that much time to explore. It's like, it's more immediate to myself. You see what I'm saying? So you're kind of in the middle
there.
But what I would say is, because you have to take, you know, so many, I mean, I don't know how many classes you have to take at a time, but if you're a full-time student, it usually takes 4 classes across. So you can, you know, you got some electives in there that you can, so take some of the things that you enjoy, and if you want to focus on, like, say, learning how to be a, you know, a bookkeeper, you know, that's what you may want to take. But then take other classes that you enjoy. Am I finished?
Well, I'm recognizing that some folks have to get to their next class.
Oh, okay.
So I want to take a moment to thank our speaker today, Halimah. Thank you so much for your time. Please check out her book, Hand the Surveys to Me. And if you're interested in reading Halimah's book, we also have a copy that you can check out from the library.
Or you can buy it.
Or you can buy it, right?
Because my book goes through everything that I've talked about today. Okay, it talks about interests, skills, values, college majors, the job search, all of that.
And if I recognize folks have to leave, but if you have a question,
I'm still here.
Halimah's still here, and you can chat with her.
I don't have to rush out. If anybody has any questions they want to ask, yes, of course, please.
Thank you.
If anybody wants to look at these, take pictures of them. That's fine. I can answer any of your questions.
Yes, now you have, I would like to pick your brain for your mind.
True, fire away.
Well, you made me feel old.
Oh no, 30's young. I'm old. I'm old. 30's young.
So far through my 30, I know I have one more.
I love it.
If I want to be an expert, I have to write a book.
I see what you're saying, though. When you write a book, people would, from reading a book, would, you know, consider you an expert.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Right. But you don't have to write a book to be an expert. But, you know, you just have to know you're an